This week at the cafe, cyber communities. This is GeoCities, perhaps the world's largest online community. Scott Kurnit is the founder of The Mining Company, an innovative approach to a co-op community. Check out Yahoo Clubs, an attempt to turn a major portal into several communities. Megan Smith runs PlanetOut, a niche community that gets 10 million page views a month. And welcome to HipBONE, a new way to go community surfing with your friends. Cyber communities coming up next.
The Net Cafe is made possible in part by CyberSmith, wired for fun and learning with locations in Cambridge, Massachusetts, Palo Alto, California, and White Plains, New York. And by TechWeb for up-to-the-minute technology news.
We're talking about cyber communities, and it's really fascinating what's happened. I mean, I guess there were the Well folks many years ago, and then I guess CompuServe forums, and then AOL, and now the web, and news groups, and everybody's into it, including my friends here.
Yeah, well, I don't know if you guys remember, but I worked at sort of one of the 3D avatar chat-based communities.
Right, that's right.
And that kind of came and
life.
It kind of went.
Yes,
so
it did.
I'm excited to see that there's a sort of a new push around community, a little more user-friendly. And pretty interesting.
Well, I kind of like that 3D stuff. I think that'll come back.
You think so?
Yeah. It's still isolated community, though. You're still on your computer all by yourself,
so?
Connecting remotely. So it's still not truly community.
Not face to face.
It's not like hanging around with you guys.
We'll talk about that later. This is Scott Kurnit, your founder of MiningCo.com. It's a very cool site, but it takes some explaining because when you look at it right away, it kind of looks a little bit like Yahoo or maybe NetCenter, sort of, you know, sort of normal portal. But there's a lot more to that. And I want you to explain the difference and what your philosophy is behind Mining Co.
Sure. I mean, first and foremost, it is in that navigation space.
Right.
But what we did was we went out and recruited over 600 experts in specific subject areas and built them mini online services that when they all aggregate together, you get a great directory and you also get a great community with chat, bulletin boards, at each of the sites.
So I heard somebody say this is like Yahoo with people. And when you go to your site, I mean, you see names and pictures. I mean, you have a sense there is a community of real human beings out there. Is that the essential part of Mining Co?
Yeah, I mean, any community to really be good, whether it's a city or whether it's a company,
right,
needs somebody who you respect to lead it. To have just a mass of people becomes anarchy. So what we've done is we said, okay, let's put people who really know what they're talking about at the helm. They'll dig up stuff on the net, they'll write original articles, they'll run chat and bulletin boards, they'll answer your email contractually in 24 hours, but
right,
you know, they're usually on it right away. So you're really in touch with getting the information and connecting with people that are interesting to you with somebody at the helm.
Okay, but the point is, as I understand it, you didn't hire these people. I mean, they contract with you, right? I mean, you sort of gathered guys who are already running cool websites. You said, let's all get together in one sort of place and we'll provide infrastructure.
Yeah, so what we did was we said, you know, you've got a great website, but let's make it all common. Let's recreate what you've done. So we now have guides operating out of over 20 countries. They all operate within the same system and structure, so we're able to pull all the chat rooms out or all the bulletin boards or all the directories. So anyone who's going in for that unified directory approach can get it, or if you're going for community, you can get that too.
So you call these people guides, and a guide is actually maybe a guy who was running his own little website, who's a real expert in some area, and now he's part of Mining Co. Is that the idea?
Exactly. So the guides are independent contractors. They work for a cut of the revenue. They're all professionals.
Okay, so it's kind of a co-op. Is that the idea?
Well, it's all the sites are company controlled because we first and foremost have to really guarantee editorial integrity and the trust between consumer
and the
total service, absolutely.
All right, but if I'm a guide, what's my job?
Your job as a guide is to run a full-fledged site on a topic, whether that's back and neck injury or video game strategies. And you are to find all the links that are relevant on the net to be better than Yahoo just in link finding. And then also we want you to run a bulletin board chat room, original content, and all of the structure that creates community by bringing people together.
Okay, and these guides can make money doing this. I mean, you're selling ads on the big site and sharing revenue with these guys?
Absolutely. The guides are basically working for 40% of the revenue and starting to make some serious money.
All right, now what are the kinds of areas you go in? I mean, it's pretty deep, right? I mean, you get to just about any interest you could think of on the Mining Co.
Well, we have 630 sites that actually cover 12,000 topics.
Wow.
So there really isn't anything at this point that we're not covering. And we cover everything from pregnancy to composite materials industry to Mark Twain.
All right, finally, let me ask you. I know you have a kind of war going on with Yahoo. You're sort of competitors with Yahoo, and I suppose that's the point. What's your disagreement with Yahoo?
Well, Yahoo doesn't list our individual sites, and
Why?
We are a network of sites. They claim that we're a network structure, yet they list all 2,000 listings into the Ziff sites, which is a sister company.
Right.
So it really isn't the right argument. And our view is you either have to be, you know, have real editorial integrity and list what's out there and provide the best for people, or you have to say it. If you can either be, for the people who are using the net and provide them what's out there, but you really have to put that message out.
Yeah.
And they're not doing that. And so a Christianity site on the mining company is not getting found on Yahoo, and it should.
All right. My guess is Mining Co. will attract enough people. Hopefully you won't have to worry about it.
We think so, too.
Thank you, Scott.
Thank you.
For URLs of today's featured websites, just go to the NetCafe site at cnptv.com.
Mark, one of the things that I'm always complaining to Andrew and Stuart is that people spend too much time surfing the web. It's a very isolated thing, and it's very antisocial. And now you've got this new technology called CoNavigator, which is kind of ruining my argument. Explain a little bit more about what CoNavigator does.
Right. Yeah, the web today is a really lonely experience, and we think we've got something to combat that. HipBONE's got the first free internet CoNavigation service. And what that is it allows two people to navigate the web together. And essentially what we can do...
So simultaneously they can surf various sites together.
Right. I click, if we're co-navigating, Jan, you click on a link, I follow. I click on a link and you follow. So we can do other things. Not only can we surf the web, but we can fill out forms, we can download files, we can play audio together, and we can watch video together at the same time. Now the way that you get HipBONE connected is you go to hipbone.com and what you do is you essentially start a Java applet that runs in your browser.
So I don't need to download a plugin. There's no special services I need.
No plugins at all. It's really easy. The only requirement is that you need Netscape, the newest Netscape and the newest Internet Explorer.
So I need the latest version,
and
then I go from there.
And those are guaranteed that you'll work.
And so some examples. When you're describing this co-navigation, to me, it seems like what I would be prone to do is if I'm trying to get connected with somebody across the country, I'm going to phone them and say, hey, let's go co-navigate together. Are there other ways that, you know, I can do that? It sounds a little inefficient to do it with on the phone.
The phone is a great way to enable a co-navigation session. There are actually other ways. You can use chat, and everybody's familiar with chat. And there's also instant messaging, which is a cool way to hook up to. Sure. So, you know, you find your whoever you're going to co-navigate with through any of those mechanisms, and you can hook up.
Okay, so give me some examples of some of the ways people are using it. It's a brand new product. I mean, it's only a few months old, but you must have some people trying it out.
Right, and it's really exciting to watch what people are actually using it for. We've got one user. She's co-navigating with her mother across the country.
Which, co-navigating with your mother even in a car is a challenge sometimes, but...
Yeah, and what she's doing is she's planning for her wedding, and she's at Bride's...
Modern Bride or something like that.
Right, yeah. That's
what it is. Okay.
ModernBride.com. And she's picking out the wedding dress and going for the bridesmaid dresses and even getting tips for the audio and
the
different types of music.
Ceremony.
The whole thing. And then after that, she goes off to Macy's.com and does the bridal registry. So it's a really interesting approach to using the web.
So I can just see the mother and the daughter in the chat room saying, I want to say ivory. No, white, ivory. No.
Right.
Just going on forever. So what are some other examples?
So there's another company called resources.com, and it's more of a business-to-business relationship. Resources.com is a portal for designers and manufacturers and buyers that all come together that want to share common information about perhaps it's actually building out office space.
Okay, so these guys can basically collaborate on the web together and do the designs and the layouts
right.
and those types
you know,
of things.
Specking out what type of chairs are involved all the way out to the what type of light bulbs are used.
So there's really a broad application. Now, as I said, this is a pretty new product. It's only a few months old. Mm-hmm. What's the next step? How are you going to take the next step forward?
So the main thing, we just want to keep making it easier. So we've got it enabled through a Java plugin or
an applet,
right. And the next step, of course, is just to make that simpler, and we've got some other plans that your viewers will see in the upcoming months.
So some ideas of getting into some online communities and making it more pervasive.
Right. We absolutely want to hook up with these online communities, and they'll actually see that because the communities, as you know, are a great way to bring people together that have a common interest.
So this is really the next step. It's really cool. CoNavigator. Check it out. Thanks.
For URLs of today's featured websites, just go to the NetCafe site at cnptv.com.
So, Megan, you are the president and CEO, big title here, of PlanetOut.
Yeah.
And I think it's got to be probably one of the largest gay and lesbian communities online. I understand you guys are on AOL, you're on the web. Why is the gay and lesbian community as a whole a natural to be on the web?
Well, yes, our site, we are the largest gay and lesbian internet site out there.
How many people?
Yeah. About 500,000 people a month visiting PlanetOut, about 10, 12 million page views.
That's good.
And I guess the reason why people are online is because it's in some places in our country and around the world, it's not safe to be out and to be openly gay or lesbian or bi or trans. And so, you know, in fact, in this country, in 41 states, you can be fired for being gay. So it's a really safe place to come online and find other gay and lesbian people. I mean, a lot of us, I live in San Francisco, so I have access to the Castro, which is a wonderful neighborhood. If you live in Washington, you got DuPont Circle. If you have New York, you have Greenwich Village. But not everyone has that. So PlanetOut is really the cyberspace gay community.
Great. So do you find that a lot of your users are coming from maybe, you know, not the larger urban centers or, you know, sort of diverse areas?
Yeah, we have people from all over the country. I'd say, you know, probably 8 or 10% of our site comes from the New York metropolitan area, but people come from all over. And in fact, 30% of the website comes from overseas. So lots of people from Canada, Japan, the UK, Germany. But we also have people from all over Africa, from Asia, from just all over the world.
So you're really providing a safe place to discuss issues. What are some of the kind of, you know, fun, interesting, or, you know, serious things that go on?
Huge range. There are some serious things. There's some fun things. We have a very big sort of film area called Popcorn Q, which is like the largest gay and lesbian film site out there. You can you can actually watch film online, and so small snippet videos, quick time, and real video.
And these are mostly movies that somehow are relating to gay and lesbian lifestyle, or just movies in general?
A whole combination. Some of them are gay-themed films, like something like In and Out, or As Good as It Gets, and some of them are more sort of drama camp, funny commercials from the past, and even some old news clips, like Anita Bryant getting a pie
that
in the face.
Was famous,
Some of those are up there, so lots of archived video.
A real history.
And, of course, with all of our different sites, there's a commerce back end, so you can buy videos online from Popcorn Q.
Which is also great because not everybody has access to the stores around.
Very important. We have music areas, we have a travel area, personal finance. We have a very serious news team. We publish 5 stories of gay and lesbian news every day.
Now, and so you have a dedicated staff of journalists that are in your company.
In Los Angeles. Right. They write all night.
Okay.
And they publish in the morning.
Right. I was actually reading tonight, there was this, you know, terrible story of a young man who was killed, I think, somewhere in, where was that?
Yeah.
And so it seemed like you had very in-depth coverage and were really exploring all the issues. Are those the kind of...
That's the kind of story. We covered the Andrew Cannon story. We covered the Tim McVeigh story. We're covering the Matthew Shepard story. Really sad stories.
Yeah.
We're able to pull together news and also work together with our nonprofit teams. People like the Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation, GLAAD, or the Human Rights Campaign, or various nonprofit groups, and link to their sites and link to action sites. Right now there's links into Matthew's, reaching Matthew's parents and donating to the causes.
Wonderful. Okay, real quick, where is the future going for PlanetOut?
Well, we've got a combination of entertainment, a lot of community, chat and message boards, personals. We're really bringing people together. I think Popcorn Q will grow up to be a gay and lesbian film channel itself.
Really popular.
But really working on making a home-based place for people to get news and information, entertainment, talk to each other, meet each other, and have a great time.
I think it's a great sense of community space for a group that really needs that space.
We're here with Larry Maggot again, syndicated columnist and all-around internet expert. Larry, we're talking about cyber communities tonight. And, you know, there's still this debate around, is a virtual friend as good as a real friend, better or worse? You know, some parents are worried that, hey, my kid's living in this sort of electronic world. What's happened to face-to-face friends?
Well, you can't get pregnant or a disease from a virtual friend. That's the good news.
Not yet.
Not yet, at least. Maybe a computer virus.
Right.
You know, you can have a relationship, and we know of cases. I guess it was Rush Limbaugh met his wife on CompuServe. But personally, I would just see him have real friends. I think there is that risk that you create this sort of isolated sort of cyber community, and you don't go out and, you know, meet real people.
But for some people, it's a very important part of their lives, and they might not otherwise have that. I mean, people say, hey, I've got friends all over the world. No, we meet every night and so on.
Oh, there are people for whom this really has become a real community.
Yeah.
And they get together, and they have parties, and they interact. And, you know, it's hard to knock it for people who are really enjoying it. I worry more about kids. When they get totally fixated on these cyber
yeah.
friends and they don't have a real life, then I just kind of worry
about
them.
Maybe it should be adults only for cyber communities.
Well, yeah, or adults that can at least have some control over what they're doing.
Last question. You know, we have cyber communities now, and the technology is kind of primitive. I mean, it's typewriter communities
yes.
in a way. What happens when we get to bandwidth in a couple of years and there's audio, video, virtual friends?
Wait, we get X-rated communities. I think there is the risk that people are going to get carried away. And again, maturity is real important. People have to look at this stuff with a grain of salt, not get too carried away, and just enjoy
yeah.
it for what it is.
For URLs of today's featured websites, just go to the NetCafe site at cnptv.com.
So, Mark, you're from Yahoo Clubs, and it seems like the portal sites are kind of going around in circles. I think community was way back at the beginning, and now suddenly community is back again 4 years later. Tell me about clubs. What is a club?
What is a club?
On the web.
For Yahoo, a club is really about just personal community space for our users. You talked about the circle and how mm-hmm. we've come around. In the past 2 years, what we've done is we've seen users saying, I want my personal space on Yahoo. I want a place I can call my own, a place that I can control
mm-hmm.
and share information with my friends and build relationships.
But this is different than a personal website, right?
Certainly.
This is a members-only kind of thing?
It can be, or it can be open to the public. It depends on the kind of member base that you're looking for. It's really about building relationships, though, and that's
mm-hmm.
the difference between us and some other sites. They're mainly focused on homepages.
Okay.
We give you the tools to build those relationships with people, whether it be a chat room, or a message board list. It's not about looking at a static page. It's
mm-hmm.
about communicating with each other.
Okay, well, let me give me a couple examples. I belong to a men's group, very California
Sorry.
Thing.
Right.
Okay, we've got together for the last 5 years
right.
on a Monday night, so I miss it a lot because I'm here at this show. But my girlfriend's in an investment club as well.
Mm-hmm.
What are some of the kind of things we could do with a Yahoo Club type thing?
For the men's club, that's a great example. Say
mm-hmm.
you couldn't make the meeting
right.
or you didn't
want to
know what's going on. People could post what happened in that meeting. They could have a discussion about it. And
mm-hmm.
say there was a good chunk of people that couldn't
mm-hmm.
make it. They could have a live chat later on in the week where they could discuss those issues a little bit more further. In the case of an investment club,
mm-hmm.
You have a lot of people in there who are talking about what happened in the market today. They're pointing out links to areas where the market is changing or little profiles of
mm-hmm.
stocks that they're they have their eye on. So it's a lot of places where they can really share information and, again, talk with each other and get into the issues.
Okay, now with the men's group, obviously maybe I don't want the whole world to
right.
see what I'm doing. So how could I make it more private, more focused just on the members of the
sure.
group?
Sure, and that's a good point. That's
mm-hmm.
what a lot of people are interested in, especially families.
Right.
They want a club that's a little bit more private. We
mm-hmm.
have the ability to make a club what we call unlisted.
Mm.
And by that, it's not searchable in the directory. It's
mm.
not accessible by anyone who does not have an invitation.
Mm.
So a member or the person who creates the club has to send an invitation out to other members. That's the way you get into the
okay.
club, and that's how you access the information.
And you need a passcode, or you can just...
It's all done through cookies, so
okay.
it's really pretty much invisible to the user.
Great, so once I'm on, I just go on, I can get on any time.
Exactly.
Okay, give me some examples of some fun, kind of crazy clubs that
sure.
people
well,
are creating.
Our number one club so far is the Hanson Fan Club, attracting
oh.
the love and the sweethearts of the Hanson everywhere.
Okay.
It has about 1,700 members, and these guys are really just using it to the fullest potential. They have this club, and they're chatting every day. You go in, the chat room is near capacity.
And these are just fans that created
fans
this?
Of Hanson. Well, it's actually the official fan club is the one that's the most popular.
Okay.
The Hanson Band has, through their manager,
mm-hmm.
set up an official club through us.
Mm.
And they post, here's what's going on with the band,
mm-hmm.
here's what's coming up, and post a little notes. Hey, from the road, Zach says hi. And
so Hanson actually is involved in
exactly,
this club.
Exactly, to
they
a certain
get
extent.
On,
and,
wow.
and they come in and get things started.
Mm-hmm.
And once they get things started, the club members take off and just let things elevate from there. That's probably a good example of one of the official clubs
right,
that are more
right.
popular.
Okay,
but
so more on the homegrown
sure,
side.
Sure, the
things,
grassroots level. There is a club, actually, that a friend of mine pointed to me to the other day for a friend that went to the Peace Corps in Mali, Africa. Mali, middle of nowhere. You wouldn't think there is an internet connection, but there happened
right.
happens to be one in a diplomat's office, or, sorry, the embassy.
Mm-hmm.
This woman who joined the Peace Corps, who was recently from Silicon Valley, joined in there and joined a club, and she shares information in Mali from what's going on over there, but likewise, her friends here communicate with her in just one forum. They say, October 9th, I'll be in a chat room, and so we can all talk with her live internationally,
mm-hmm.
keeping that relationship going despite the fact that we're on two different
continents. So it's a pretty broad range.
Well, certainly.
We'll have to go check out Yahoo Clubs.
Definitely.
For URLs of today's featured websites, just go to the NetCafe site at cnptv.com.
So, David, we're talking about online communities, and it would seem kind of crazy to have a discussion about online communities and not have one of the largest online communities on the web today, and that's GeoCities. Now, you're the founder, and, you know, I have one question. Before we start talking about GeoCities, I'm a little confused. There's all this talk about online communities, and there's all this talk about portals. What are they both the same thing? What's the difference between a portal and an online community?
Jane, that's a good question. I think we should start with how we define online community, and we really define it four ways. One, common interest. People come together because they have a desire to meet others of similar interests. So whether it's about sports or politics or finance,
movies,
or entertainment, movies, TV shows, GeoCities has 41 neighborhoods and 500 some themes of common interest. So that's number one. Number two, people join a community because they're looking to get something out of it. They're looking to meet new friends, they're looking to share their experiences, thoughts, and ideas, or maybe they join a community because by virtue of the fact they join, they get discounts on goods and services, so there's some payback. Number three, every community, whether it's in the real world or on the internet, has an economic infrastructure, and we have that at GeoCities. We're primarily advertising supported. And then number four is what I call the litmus test, and that's the participation and effort and the contribution the members make. I think what creates a community is when the members care about the site, they put their own effort into helping make it grow. That's what we are as a community. Now, a portal site's a little different. A portal site is a place where people come to and they pass through. That's the definition of what a portal is. And at GeoCities, we found that people come and they stay. They find others who have a similar interest, or they set up their own homepage, or go in one of our chat rooms. So that, I think that's the difference.
But one of the things with portal sites, though, is that when people are trying to really grow their portal site, they add things like community or chat, free home pages, which I know is a really big part of GeoCities.
Right.
So are the lines getting grayer between an online community in its purest form and a portal site?
Oh, I think so. And when you look at what community is really ideally suited to the internet. And the internet was formed as a joint venture between the government and academia and business. And it was to allow those people to share common interest on defense projects and other things. Well, GeoCities has really tapped into what the core strength of the internet is. One, it gives people a sense of participation. It gives them an opportunity to express themselves. And two, it allows them to meet other people of similar interest. And I think a lot of other sites are just now tapping into the power of what the internet's all about.
So with GeoCities, you've got a lot of people coming to your site. I mean, how many users do you have today? How many?
We have over 2.5 million active members and 15 million visitors a month. So it's a busy site.
Busy site, and you've organized it in neighborhoods, is that right? Or how does it?
GeoCities has 40 communities of interest. And the interesting thing is we've created a context for those themes, and we use the names of real places to evoke a theme. So Silicon Valley is our community for high tech.
And we've got Wall Street.
We got Wall Street for finance. We have Bourbon Street for jazz. We have Nashville for country music. We have Hollywood for entertainment. And so we've created a state of mind by using familiar place names. And those are the broad neighborhood definitions in GeoCities.
Okay, so I jump into, let's say, Bourbon Street, and
right.
I'm a jazz aficionado, and I want to start my own homepage. The one thing, you're offering me a free homepage.
Right.
But the one thing is to design a homepage, it's really technical. It's very complicated.
You know, Jane, if you can use a mouse and if you're a jazz fan, you could have great jazz page up in Bourbon Street in 5-10 minutes. You can point to your favorite jazz sites on the net. You can upload graphics of your favorite jazz artists. And most important, you can meet other jazz fans right in Bourbon Street.
So basically, I can pick the community I want to be in, and I can create my own homepage. And then the world is my oyster.
You know, we have some interesting examples of members who have all gotten together and joined in the same street or block in the neighborhood, and that started a little club, and then it gets bigger and bigger from there, and all of a sudden you have a thriving community all around jazz.
Well, if people want to check out the real online community, GeoCities is one of the hot sites to check out. Thanks so much, David.
www.geocities.com.
So what did we find out is new with the cyber communities?
Well, I thought PlanetOut was one of the best uses of community, really taking a group that needs a community safe, a safe space, and brings them all together. Very impressive. And brings them out.
And what was best for you?
The co-navigator tool was really cool. I mean, I think it's the beginning of something beautiful.
Wow. Well, Mining Co., we don't call it mining company, but it's miningco.com, with Scott Kurnit, the guy I talked to. It's a very interesting set. It really puts people back on the web. We complain about it's all sort of impersonal.
Right.
You really know there are human beings behind it, and it makes a big difference to me, so I kind of like that. Anyhow, that's our look at cyber communities, and that's it for tonight at CyberSmith. We'll see you here next time.
The Net Cafe is made possible in part by CyberSmith, wired for fun and learning, with locations in Cambridge, Massachusetts, Palo Alto, California, and White Plains, New York. And by TechWeb, for up-to-the-minute technology news. To purchase a videotape copy of today's program, call toll-free 1-888-310-7850. Please specify the show number and the topic.